much. First of all, I really personally thank Dr. Vasim Wari for this wonderful creation of International Knowledge Cafe. It's a wonderful name, actually. So I'm really excited to be part of this. I will not take much more time because I know time is a big concern for all of us. And I'm from a human rights background in India. I did my PhD in human rights, and very recently I joined as a faculty of human rights in an open university. And I would like to connect the virtual education system and how Indian education system is now facing the challenges as well as using the opportunity of this isolation and quarantine period to do something for the student and how the student is actually coping up with this new normalcy in COVID-19 era. But with this also, I would point out some human rights aspects that are facing in Indian scenario in this current COVID situation. So my main theme is virtual education as well as human rights scenario in India. First, I would like to continue with this, that human rights is a big challenging situation in Indian society. With this wonderful networking system, but as well as we all know that we all have challenges in this current COVID situation. Domestic violence is on high risk in Indian scenario. Unwanted pregnancy is on high risk in Indian scenario nowadays. We don't know that how women and girls are facing day-to-day challenges in their home, putting them under the additional stress and a potential increasing their high risk of infections. Across the globe, we are facing the situation same. But who are in the Indian context, they might know that we have a distinct divergence of economical situation as the society is divided in distinct parts. It is based on urbanized sector and the other part is the rural sector. So who are in the rural sector, they are facing so much challenges. Number one, they are facing lack of opportunities of economical stability due to this lockdown. Number two, who are in the urban sector, and they are basically the migrants workers, they are also facing the challenges that the working capacity has been very, very low in this time of COVID scenario. So migrant workers are traveling across the India and they are almost traveling 2,000 miles in a day and they are reaching their main destination, their home. And after this, with this scenario, when actually lockdown have been started in the March, the government didn't much excited to bring them back into their home. So the situation is getting worse now because they are the carrier of COVID and they are positive of COVID, and amount has been increasing as they are traveling so many kilometers together by reaching their home. And while they're reaching the home, they are not getting any kind of salary or economical stability. So the situation for them is worse. And as they are mentally, economically, physically not well, they are putting pressure on their families and the who are there in their home, the mothers, the wife, the daughters, they are facing the challenges of the psychological pressure of this working capabilities. So the dual challenges are there in the Indian scenario. This is the human rights aspect. Along with that, the pressure on economy is so much that India is facing challenges with the sustainability factors. Youth, who are the major, role playing, a game changer in this way, they are not at all very much politically literate. So the problem of youth is they are not very much prone to know about these social parameters as well as the political participation. So youth our asset as well as youth are the biggest problem. So how to deal with this? Some of the Indian institutions, educational institutions, they have already launched virtual education system, webinar, web to make literate, not only in the field of politics, but in the field of social awareness. And available with their social media, in Facebook, in Twitter, in LinkedIn, in Instagram, but how they are using it. So the media literacy, especially the social media literacy, is one of the biggest tasks that some of the major educational institutions have been already launched. Like, for example, Amity University have opened their resources of their libraries to the students. Like this, many other private universities as well as government universities have already opened their resources to the students. But how to utilize that? They are not being very much prone to use appropriate use of this internet. They are more prone to use rather in YouTubes. They are very much enjoying the videos. It could be fake videos. How to know about that, whether the video is fake or not? In Amity University, that personally I am attached with them, that's why I'm telling this, they have a wonderful session that how to detention fake news and fake social media videos. Because this is very dangerous to the youth, because the youth are being free of mind and they are very much sensitive. They are very much conscious as well as they are very much sensitive at the same time. So it's very easy to motivate in a very nationalized, I'm using the term nationalized in a way, to make them agitated. So as a researcher, as academicians, it is our duty to make them aware about the appropriateness, about the actual scenario, what is happening. And of course, with their full political participation. Because without political participation, the policymakers may not be able to get the actual research from them. And with this, I would really like to show, with my talk, I don't have any PowerPoint presentation here, that how COVID-19 situation in India. Life is not same in India as well as with nation like 1.3 billion is up against the enemy, which is actually invisible to us. So yet it is seemed invincible, and present generation have never witnessed such fear of any pandemic in their lifetime. As India prepares its defense against local transmission of virus, public health measurements, community preparedness, and the practice of social distancing. Rather, I would not use the social distancing, rather physical distancing has become a critical. Why the Indian government have been criticized though maintaining the physical distancing? Because in the initial stage, when the COVID-19 have been come around, they are not taking the appropriate measurement of maintaining the physical distancing. And it is not possible in this dense population. And I know personally, because I was there in Delhi for 3 years, it is absolutely not possible to maintain the physical distancing in a true such a way. But the current government have been so much criticized that they are not taking the initiative in the initial stage when COVID-19 actually came. But now with this, after Janta curfew and the long-term period of the lockdown period have been done already. One by one, the step has been taken to unlock and how we can actually come back to normal economical development situation. But it is not so easy because we have already 3 months over, and people who actually the daily earner, daily wages, they are not getting salary, they are not getting any monies. Rather, the government announced for lump sum rupees of loan the loan is not the solution. We don't know, we don't have money in our hands. Loan is not solution. How to return back? How to boost the economic? How to boost it up? We don't have any kind of such policies, but I really hope that because Indian economy and economists, they are very, very strong. So I hope that it will be having so many policies together, and it's just a hope. But to maintain the physical distancing, it's still now not happening. Though government and the state government, each and every state government have their own policies. Kerala, personally, I'm telling, I'm living in Hyderabad, that is under Telangana government. They are doing brilliant job in the time, in the period of social distancing or physical distancing. Kerala government is doing brilliant work in terms of the maintaining of physical distancing and the mobilization of youth. They are doing great. Proper sanitization and personal hygiene is being maintained in each and every sector, but not all the state government, because you know that it's a federal government, so central and state, they have a clear distinct idea of their execution of the policies. 14 days quarantine is mandatory, some state, not all state. So while coming from another state, I have to be 14 days quarantine in my home state, and then only I will go back to new normal life. So it is mandatory to some state. So that is one of a good step by the state government as well. And it will not be wiped out in a fortnight. It will take some time. And I think with our personal care, with our governmental help, as well as I would like to really, really appreciate the work of NGOs and the civil societies. They did brilliant work in terms of the civil society. How to help with the very small scale people together and who have been locked in a state where they are not belonging, and how to return back to them with the Indian Railway services have been not there, but some of the very personal knowing people, like for example Sonu Sood, have already donated 10 lakh for returning back the migrants worker to Bihar, and from Mumbai to Bihar they traveled by bus. It was donated by Sonu Sood, a famous actor. So this kind of thing is personally happening, but that wasn't initiated by government. Central government has invoked the power of the Epidemic Disease Act that has been in from 1897. But it was not been very much effective way, though we have so many acts enhanced the preparedness, the responsive efforts of COVID-19 declared and notified disaster. The state disaster fund as well as the PM Care Fund have been already launched. I hope that it will be in an appropriate usefulness of this funding. Because as we all know that the utilization of those funds, sometimes it's not happening according to the citizen's need. So I hope that it will be utilized in appropriate way in a humanitarian aspects. An outbreak of COVID-19 is equally dangerous for the people from all sector of the society, starting from the economy, starting from the politics, starting from educational background. Everyone is mandated to follow the protocols of physical distancing, and this pandemic will significantly affect workers, informal sector, formal sectors consisting of 93% of workforce have been disturbed due to this COVID-19. So it is the biggest crisis ever, as rightly pointed out Dr. Shahzad Iqbal in his presentations, that it is a similar situation in Pakistan, India, doesn't matter. The situation of crisis is for all of us. So I think it's a high time to react together, to do something together, to do some research together, irrespective of any boundaries, irrespective of any religion, irrespective of any region. So in the financial institutions, if we would work together, we will definitely find some solutions. Because individually, we are nothing in front of this dangerous virus. But if we are together, we act together, we do some research together, it will be definitely fruitful for all of the nations. Thank you so much for this opportunity. I would really like to stop myself here. And if anyone would like to ask some questions.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Swati. It is very nice talk, and we listen many new things about the India, the current situation in your state and in whole India, and about the population which they are suffering. So any question from the audience, please? Anyone from the audience, question?
Yes. No question. Can I make a small like discussion and comment if I can?
Yes.
Since the topic is a bit close to my sphere, I can talk about, nowadays, from domestic violence suffer people not only in India, it is worldwide action, and even in European countries, it is recorded that domestic violence really increased during the pandemic lockdown. So don't be so disappointed with your country. It's happened everywhere, not in your country. But I want us to highlight that what I like in Indian law that you have positive discrimination. I like it what we don't have in Georgia. It means that every representative of every nationalities, religious minorities have their quotas in public offices, in political parties, and it is really a good chance to make them involved in political life of the country. Really, we don't have this, and while talking about human rights and discriminations in Georgia, I always highlight and stress this law in India. Of course, some of them criticize and tell that it is discrimination. However, it is positive discrimination, that the representative of every sphere should have quotas in public spheres. So it's very good. I appreciate this law. And just this everywhere happened, domestic violence.
Okay. Thank you. During the pandemic. But I listened that in current scenario during the pandemic, the lawyers are very happy because divorce rate is increasing in the world.
Yes, divorce also.
Domestic violence. So this is a very, very negative side or dark side of the pandemic, because we are not ready to bear each other's 24 hours or 1 week, 1 month like that. So right now we have to face it, and I hope so something is in the future.
Yeah.
Right. Any other questions,
really?
Please? Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Swati. It was a very nice session, and we learned very new things from your country and from the COVID-19, and hope we will see you again in future sessions as well. So here we move on the next session. Yes, please. Who is there? Here is Professor Dr. Beatriz from Brazil, and she is very, very experienced. I think the most experienced professor from Brazil in our cafe, and she has some little problem with reference to speaking English, and maybe to use the translator. I want to request all of you that because the live sessions and the online sessions, we have some limitations. So we have to change our mind to listen a little clear, carefully, because the target of our cafe is to learn the knowledge, not enjoy the culture or like that. So I request to Professor Beatriz from Brazil, please discuss and tell us some new ideas and with reference to Brazil, what is happening there and what you think about the future post-pandemic COVID-19 and what will be happen in future. Thank you, please.
Okay, thank you very much. We are going to start the presentation. Thank you very much for watching. Beatriz, Professor Beatriz is going to start talking about the impacts of COVID-19 in Brazil. She's going to speak in Portuguese first, and I will translate for her, okay?
Okay.
Just 1 minute, please.
Okay.
Yes. Can you see this?
Yes. Yes.
This is light.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you.
Boa tarde. É um prazer estar aqui com vocês e participando deste momento especial.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here participating of this special moment.
Welcome.
Aqui é somente um mapa para localizar o Brasil aqui e o Paquistão no outro local.
Here we are just showing a map showing where Brazil is and where Pakistan is.
Nós temos uma população no Brasil de aproximadamente 212 milhões, isso dados de ontem.
We have a population in Brazil of 212 million of people.
Nós temos uma população, o Brasil tem uma população equivalente a 2,76% da população do mundo todo.
Brazilian's population is equivalent to 2.73% of the total world population.
A população do Brasil, né, tem uma média de 25 pessoas por quilômetro quadrado. E isso é equivalente, né, a 87% da população vive na região urbana.
Ok. The population in Brazil are 25 per kilometer and 87.6% of the population is urban.
A média de idade da população brasileira hoje é de 33 anos.
The median age in Brazil is 33.5 years old.
O coronavírus no Brasil, com dados atuais, né, de hoje, das 4 horas. Então, nós temos de mortes no Brasil aproximadamente 48 mil pessoas. Nós temos pessoas que recuperaram em torno de 520 mil e pacientes passam de 1 milhão. Em condições suaves, né, mais ou menos, temos 440 mil. Em condições sérias, severas, aproximadamente 8 mil pessoas.
Now we are showing the data that we searched until June 15th. 4 p.m. We have 48,000 deaths and 520,000 people almost at about recovered. In treatment, we have 1 million at about 1 million people. Live cases, we have 44,000. In serious cases, we have 8,000 at about.
Nós temos um diagnóstico, os impactos que a COVID está causando na economia, né? No mundo todo, nós vamos ter uma queda do PIB em torno de 3%, né? Dados do FMI, dados recentes, e no Brasil nós vamos ter uma queda de aproximadamente 5,3% da economia. São os impactos causados pela COVID.
Here is a small diagnosis about the economic impacts in Brazil. We think our GDP will drop 3% in 2020.
Os setores mais afetados da Covid no Brasil foi o comércio, restaurantes, bares e similares, hotéis, setor de serviços e a educação, que é o meu assunto principal.
These are the sectors most affected by COVID-19. And as you can see, the education, as Beatriz is saying, is one of the most affected here too.
Então, nós temos o impacto da COVID na educação global. Ações foram tomadas, né? Foram a partir do momento que surgiu a pandemia, onde, para reduzir o contágio, houve o afastamento dessas pessoas e o fechamento da suspensão das aulas presenciais em 188 países. E, ao todo, foram afetados 1.576 alunos, ou seja, 91% foram afetados pela pandemia. Isso são dados da própria Unesco.
Okay, since the COVID-19 started, many prevention actions were taken to reduce the contagion, and many students were affected by these actions, as Beatriz is saying. Until now, many people in Brazil are not having classes. Until now, they are not having classes.
E foram dados estatísticos da educação no Brasil. Nós temos no Brasil um sistema educacional que ele é regido pela Lei de Diretrizes da Educação Básica, LDB, de 1976, aonde a educação básica contempla educação infantil e educação de creche e pré-escola. O ensino fundamental é médio. Ele pode ser oferecido por meio do ensino regular, da educação especial e da educação de jovens e adultos. A educação superior, por sua vez, oferece cursos de graduação, de pós-graduação, sequenciais e cursos de extensão. Além da educação escolar, a LDB ainda define educação profissional tecnológica nas modalidades de qualificação profissional, técnica e de nível médio, tecnológico e de graduação e de pós-graduação.
Here, in this slide, we are just showing how Brazil offers the levels of education for their students.
Estudantes na rede pública de ensino, segundo o curso frequentado, em 2018, nós temos dados do IBGE que são somente de 2018. Esses dados acontecem de dois em dois anos. Então, nós temos em torno de 40 milhões de alunos, né? Ou seja, na creche e pré-escola, nós temos 74%, aproximadamente. O ensino fundamental regular, 82%. O ensino médio regular, 87%. Superior, que é a graduação, 25%, especialização, mestrado e doutorado, somente 22%.
Here, Beatriz is saying that we have 4 million students in Brazil, and in the specialization or superior studies, we have just 29% of the population.
Então, os problemas imediatos, nós temos, né, a pandemia está mudando de forma definitiva um dos negócios mais rentáveis, que mais cresce no país, que é a educação superior. Então, ele foi afetado fortemente, a educação superior. Com os estudantes em casa, nas redes de ensino, precisaram intensificar as aulas online. Mas as aulas online, o sistema à distância pode impulsionar a inadimplência destes alunos e afetar a captação de novos alunos, porque não tem esse contato físico com o aluno.
Beatriz is saying that as we don't have the contact with the students, they are not coming to study, people are letting to pay the schools, the private schools, and it's possible that we cannot capture more students to start studying here.
Então, nós temos na rede privada, que é onde são os cursos predominantes, os cursos superiores de especialização e mestrado, onde em 2018, 74% dos estudantes frequentavam as instituições de ensino privada. Já nos cursos de pós-graduação e na rede privada, nós temos em torno de 71% de alunos, isso dados do IBGE de 2018.
The private network remained predominant in higher education, specialization, master's and doctorate courses.
Alunos na rede privada. No total, nós temos 6,5 milhões de alunos que estão nas redes de ensino superior privado, dos quais 2,2 milhões são à distância, na modalidade à distância. O problema é que a qualidade, que a modalidade à distância tem mensalidades mais acessíveis do que a presencial. E agora, com os alunos que estão em casa, da forma que estão tendo a aula, eles acham que não estão recebendo a aula de qualidade e estão requisitando um valor menor das suas mensalidades, né? E aí a gente sabe que mesmo assim, a pandemia já quebrou aquele paradigma entre aluno e professor, né, sobre o ensino à distância. Assim, são necessárias algumas estratégias emergenciais.
BA is saying now that it's necessary some emergential attitudes here, because students are not agreeing with the online studying because they think they are not receiving a good product or a general product at home. So they are asking to the universities to pay less than they used to pay before.
As estratégias adotadas, uma das principais estratégias adotadas foi o fórum invertido, né, que é uma ferramenta virtual assíncrona, bem conhecida no mundo virtual, ao qual o aluno tem a oportunidade de aprofundar os conteúdos abordados nas aulas, sanar suas dúvidas e debater diferentes assuntos ligados nas disciplinas, e se relacionar com outros alunos, com outros estudantes ao mesmo tempo.
Here the system used is the inverted forum, where the student can have the opportunity to ask the teacher his doubts, to debate with the other students different subjects that they had in class with other students.
As estratégias adotadas por uma das universidades da onde eu trabalho, tá? Então, a Unipac Best desenvolveu a implementação de aulas no ambiente virtual e o aprendizagem em três momentos específicos, né? Então, quando surgiu os primeiros indícios de distanciamento social, no início de março, solicitou a todos os professores a inserção imediata de todo o conteúdo na plataforma Unimestre. Concentrou as atividades acadêmicas na plataforma digital, direcionou todo o atendimento administrativo e financeiro no sistema home office de todos os seus colaboradores.
Dr. Beatriz is talking now about how the university where she works, what are the strategies that they are using to teach their students, okay, since the COVID-19 started?
Uma das estratégias foi, no ambiente virtual, hospedou todos os livros, textos, exercícios e atividades aos alunos, a biblioteca digital, laboratórios virtuais nas áreas de engenharia, de saúde, de ergo e no gastronomia, também desenvolveu uma aprendizagem, acho que eu pulei uma, né? Aprendizagem colaborativa em redes de atividades como desafio científico, onde envolveu todos os alunos e a comunidade acadêmica nas redes sociais da universidade.
Yeah, in this slide you could see some of the strategies that the university is using to overcome this situation. Here in the slide we are going to see more strategies used by them.
Aí com todos os professores capacitados nas novas tecnologias de comunicação e informação, adotou as novidades, né, que tinha o EdTech, lançando a sala virtual com a integração do plataforma Unimestre de ferramentas do Google for Education, oferecendo aulas em tempo real online. Adotou também o e-learning, concentrou em um único ambiente pautado no princípio da usabilidade todos os materiais educacionais e todas as atividades acadêmicas também. E utilizou de forma mais acentuada as metodologias ativas, intensificando o uso de plataformas virtuais por meio da modalidade de educação à distância, e não educação à distância mesmo. Neste sentido aqui, essa modalidade da plataforma virtual era em tempo real, onde os alunos estavam ao mesmo tempo, no mesmo horário de aula, junto com o seu professor, no mesmo horário que eles estariam da forma presencial.
In this strategy here, Beatriz is saying that they are having classes in real time. The teacher will be all the time of the class with her students teaching and answering their questions.
Com as três etapas cumpridas pela faculdade, e ela cumprindo as metas da Unesco e a educação à distância, e com a determinação do Ministério da Educação, assim garantiu a aprendizagem, a equidade, respeitando os fatores limitantes e os acessos dos alunos à tecnologia. Então, tinha essa preocupação que os alunos não pudessem ter todas as tecnologias necessárias, né? Então, utilizou-se um acesso, ampliou-se a rede de distribuição, de espaço, de internet, assim, em 3,4 mil% a capacidade para que todos os alunos pudessem ter acesso.
Here they are improving the quality of the internet resources for the students to have equity, and the teachers will be able to respect their limitations and help them with more access to technology.
Bom, então, baseado em tudo que foi falado, existem algumas necessidades que precisam ser feitas, alguns planos que precisam ser feitos para a recuperação econômica, principalmente após a Covid. Então, os planos emergentes quais são? As pessoas deverão ser digitais e mais flexíveis, o professor passa a ser um agente mediador do conhecimento, ao qual ele somente está ali trilhando, mostrando os caminhos para o aluno. O aluno tem que buscar sozinho. E nós precisamos aprender a aprender diariamente.
Beatriz is explaining here the three topics of the recovery plans that must be used now in order to